Grateful to you ladies, and I'm grateful to my hosts for having me in their home. It's been such a wonderful time staying with them, and Monique for inviting me. I have a daughter who lives in North Dakota in Williston that wants to move to Sandpoint, and so she's been asking me to film it on Marco Polo and send her all these beautiful pictures of Sandpoint, and you've got her convinced. And I'm almost there, but I don't like to shovel snow, so I'll come and visit my daughter. I'll come visit my daughter, but thank you so much. Thank you so much for having me. Oh yeah, I can punch this. Continued for quite some time after they murdered my husband. The shots continued to pellet the truck. LaVoie Finicum was murdered by politically driven, out of control government agents during an illegal roadblock known as a kill stop, January 26, 2016, a day before his 55th birthday. He had gone to Oregon to stand peacefully for property rights, for our ever disappearing liberties, for who he considered to be his neighbor, Dwight and Susie Hammond, for you and for me. Upon impact, he left his truck alone with his hands up in the air. He was surrounded by 30 plus highly trained and heavily armed officers. There were snipers in the trees. And without mercy, they shot him 3 times in the back with his empty hands still raised in the air. A planned roadblock with no warrants, no broken laws, murdered, assassinated, with no due process and no trial by a jury. What were they afraid of? Why was he murdered? Senator Wyden and Governor Brown and other local Oregon officials wanted what they called the virus of freedom to be stopped from spreading, and so they sent a memo to Director Comey and Attorney General Lynch, Attorney General Loretta Lynch, and asked for a swift resolution in that memo. The result was the murder of LaVoie and the arrest of many of the men and women who had gone to Malheur. They used their partners, the national media outlets, fake news, to control the narrative and demonize those who were politically standing for our freedoms. They label lynched them, labeling them white racist, claiming to belong to a sovereign citizen terrorist group, or that they were bitter religious zealots clinging to their guns and religion. Many times in this country, we have watched out of control protests. In Baltimore, the mayor said, "Let it burn. Give them space to destroy." In Ferguson, the governor waited 48 hours before he offered any support. In New York, Mayor de Blasio told the police to stand down and, quote, said, "Give them time to blow off some steam," end quote. In the Dakotas, the pipeline protest went on for months, destroying many personal properties and setting off a bomb on a bridge. The Antifa groups protesting on college campuses against conservative speakers or protesting opposing groups in cities where the police were asked to stand down, watching the two groups collide, which ended in another life lost. All of these protests mentioned were not peaceful, yet they were allowed to continue, and some for months. Why? Why is it because they were politically correct? None of that behavior went on at Malheur, none. They were peacefully just wanting their voices to be heard, peacefully exercising their First Amendment rights, and yes, Senator Wyden was correct. Their message was spreading, and people could resonate with the message of freedom, of liberty, of personal property. And he and Governor Brown wanted that voice of liberty silenced. In traveling the country, speaking, I've been completely out of my element, as you can see. This is not natural for me. I've had to study and learn and articulate my position. I've had to have confidence and trust in the public square. I've gone from being chuck wagon mom and grandma to a woman rancher activist speaking out all overnight and without the void. Traveling these 2 years, my objective has been to talk about who the real man LaVoie Finicum was. I did not want the false narrative spewed through the primetime media to be the last anyone heard about LaVoie and what he was standing for. The media is not in the business of telling the truth. Their job, their motive, and their mission is to create an illusion in order to blur our reality. So they do this by manipulating our information and thinking, and thus turning us into mindless robots. They don't like our country very much, our free society, our individual liberty, our flag, our constitution. They just want to divide and destroy us. I've had many challenges, as you can imagine. I didn't expect to be followed by the FBI and the BLM law enforcement to my speaking engagements, threatening to raid them, trying to bully and intimidate the sponsors to cancel them, or contacting my local law enforcement to keep an eye on me and all who came to my home and to the other events. I have been label lynched as well as a sovereign citizen terrorist, profiled as a domestic right-wing extremist, and judged by the American public for standing with my husband as a dual Federalist. I have been labeled anti-government and put on their watch lists. I am not anti-government. I am, as was my husband, for pro-responsible, limited government. I wanted to know what a sovereign citizen terrorist was, so I had to go look it up. I had no idea what they were calling me. So I went on to the FBI website, and there were 4 pages of description of what that particular definition meant. And I've just condensed it into a paragraph. So here's that. The FBI considers sovereign citizen extremists involved in domestic terrorist movement, an anti-government group, is closely related to the lands movement. Sovereign citizens do not represent an anarchist group, nor are they a militia, although they sometimes use and buy illegal weapons, refer to themselves as constitutionalists. Many believe that only white men have rights. Sovereign citizens don't pay their taxes, use fake currency, passports, license plates, and driver's licenses, don't recognize government authority, courts, or law enforcement. Sovereign citizens commit murder and physical assault. They threaten judges and law enforcement. This type of behavior is associated with rural and small town whites in the American West. According to a survey of law enforcement personnel in 2014, sovereign citizens are now regarded as the number one terrorist threat in America. Yeah, let that sink in. Talk about label lynching. So if we're constitutionalists or involved in the Western lands issues here in the West, then we are considered sovereign citizen terrorists. and we are to be put on a domestic terrorist watch list? It's true. I'm on that list. And many of my friends are on that list. And to quote my husband, what are we becoming? This is not America. This is not who we are. May 3rd, 2017, FBI Director Comey testified that he had approximately 2,000 open terrorist investigations, of which 300 might be contributed to foreign and non-citizens. The rest of the open investigations for terrorist actions and or behaviors in America were American citizens. 1,700 citizens were being investigated as possible terrorists out of their open cases. My first question to Mr. Comey would have been, what definition of terrorist are you using when you apply that to ordinary American citizens? My second question would be, why is a rancher who starts a backfire on his personal property to stop the fire that is fast approaching in his home considered, labeled, prosecuted, and jailed as a terrorist? My next question would be, why would hardworking American citizens, ranchers, farmers, miners from across this country be considered terrorists if they stand up to the overreaching BLM and environmental groups who are stealing their property, their way of life, and in our family's case, the life of my husband? Why? Why are we being label lynched? My story continues. I have to go back just a little bit. You know, it's been 2.5 years. Look at the headlines today. Who's in them? Crooked Comey. Loretta Lynch is implicated again. When are we going to stand up and demand that they take responsibility for their illegal actions? I was forced off my ranch and insulated from my ranching duties for almost 2 years because the BLM refused to follow their own federal regulations or acknowledge that I was my husband's widow and wife. They denied that I had any right to the permit and pretended that it simply was terminated upon his death. They refused to communicate with me or my attorneys. Then finally, after speaking with whomever would listen to me, I was a pest, they decided to meet with us. And I was able to return to Tuckup and put my cows on there almost 2 years later. But I have to tell you, it had to take a change in administration for that to even happen. While I am grateful for this victory, for me and my family, a much needed victory, there is still so much for us to do. There are so many other families suffering around this country who simply feel that suffering around this country that the government is reaching out and they are destroying their lives. For instance, Joe Robertson, a 78-year-old veteran, sentenced to 8 months in jail for a natural water pond on his property. I met Joe when I was traveling and speaking up in Montana. I could not believe, you know, I was a housewife. I was in my own little bubble. It was very safe in my bubble. And until my husband was murdered, I had no idea that these things were happening. The Dan sisters, Robert Force in New York, who lost his farm. The Hammonds in Oregon, Texas ranchers, the Hages, the Bundys. The list continues, and it goes on and on and on. I am fighting to have my husband's rifle and personal belongings returned to us. I have fought to have my foster license reinstated. I have fought for the rights to my husband's cattle brand. I had to fight for my husband's book, the rights to that. I received threatening hate mail. Our family has dealt with workplace retaliation. We have dealt with family and church members' judgments, ridicule, and isolation. This in particular has been the hardest to endure without malice. I've had to learn how to ranch, how to ride a horse, much better than I was doing before. I was on the grandkid horse, but I have graduated to Blondie, and I have ridden my husband's horse, which I feel that a great accomplishment. I've learned how to fence. I've learned how to brand, how to drive and operate farm equipment. My husband was one that he babied me, and I loved it. He took care of me. He made everything very, very comfortable for me every time I was out with him. But I have learned to do all of these things for myself now. I've had donations from many of you across the United States to help feed my cows for an entire summer in a feedlot when I had nowhere to put them, for funeral costs for the autopsy, to bring Lavoie's body home. I've had wonderful family members and friends who have come far and wide to help teach me and to ranch with me. I've had family who have shared their land for my cows to graze on so that I wouldn't have to sell out or lose our family heritage and way of life. I've had to have many attorneys to deal with a wide variety of legal issues we were confronted with. Other professionals such as editors, publishers, and personal consultants and media advisors, bodyguards. My life was completely changed in every way possible. There has been so much our family has gone through. Even though it's been hard and frightening at times, I have seen God's hand in this amazing journey, guiding so many of us to this fight for liberty. I have seen unconditional love and support from so many of you across this country, and I thank you very much. And our family loves you dearly. Many have asked, how do I keep going? I have some favorite words to a hymn that come to my mind. Though hard to you this journey may appear, grace shall be as your day. Gird up your loins, fresh courage take. Our God will never us forsake. And a lot of people have asked, why aren't you angry? And music speaks to me. And it comforts me. And this particular hymn describes where I find my peace. Where can I turn for peace? Where is my solace when other sources cease to make me whole? When with a wounded heart, anger, or malice, I draw myself apart searching my soul. Where when my aching grows, where when I languish, where in my need to know, where can I turn? Where in this quiet hand to calm my anguish? Who can understand? He, only one. He answers privately, reaches my reaching, in my Gethsemane, Savior and friend. Gentle the peace he finds for my beseeching, constant he is, and kind, love without end. You know, my Father in heaven and my Savior Jesus Christ have never left me alone. That is where I turned the moment we heard, and ever since. And they have continued to carry me, as you have, when I couldn't walk on my own. Through the atonement, I have learned to forgive, to trust, and to heal. Through my Savior, I seek and find my needed peace. This is why I'm not angry. This is why I'm able to continue on. President Thomas S. Monson said, when we qualify ourselves by our worthiness, when we strive with faith, nothing wavering, to fulfill the duties appointed to us, when we seek the inspiration of the Almighty in the performance of our responsibilities wherever they are, we can achieve the miraculous. And we have seen miracles. We have seen miracles in the last 2 years. We've seen not guilty verdicts up in Oregon. We have seen the case dismissed in Nevada. We have seen patriots across this nation waking up and going to work to preserve our liberties. We have seen that. I wanted to talk a little more about who my husband was. And first, I'll just tell you a little bit about us. Aren't those such cute pictures? What a cute little boy. We are proud parents of 12 children, that's what I always say. When I married the boy, he was the package deal. He had 6 kids and I had 3. We had 1 together and we adopted 2 boys. We did therapeutic foster care for teenage boys for 18 years and we adopted 2 of those young men. We had over 60 of them in our home over those years. And it was a very busy household. The roof was barely attached, let me tell you. It was a very growing period of time for all of us, and we had a wonderful life. Lavoie, oh, I forgot to mention the most important part. I am a grandma of 26 grandchildren now. And 4 more are due this year. Isn't that exciting? I'm almost at 30.
Wow.
Isn't that amazing? When you have lots of children, they come in batches. They don't just come 1 at a time. They come 4, 5, and 6 at a time. You know, it's so wonderful. I remember the year that Lavoie died, 5 of my daughters were pregnant, and they were so sad that they thought their dad was not going to get to know their kids. And then light bulb came on. He's playing with them now. He gets to interact with them now before they come down to this earth. And that was very warming to all of us to think of it that way. But Lavoie loved his God. He loved his family. He loved life. He lived life to the fullest. He loved to play, to tease. And boy, did he like to tease. He loved to tease me. And he loved to work hard. He spent years loving and teaching disadvantaged teenage boys in our homes. He loved the neighbors, and he gave freely of his time and what he had. I remember many times that he would just pack up some things out of the house and take it to someone who really needed it, or give a job to a homeless gentleman that needed a job and a place to stay when he was managing apartments, and he would give him an apartment and give him his tools and give him the ability to be able to work. I was so impressed by that. His dream to own his own ranch was realized. He loved ranching and he loved his cows. And I don't know how many of you are ranchers, but we really get attached to our animals. We really get attached to our cows and we know them by number or name, whichever way you go and do it. He was strong and courageous. He was principled and trustworthy. He was loving and kind, and he was my true friend. He loved his freedom, his agency given to him by God. He loved his children and grandchildren so much, so he was willing to stand for them. He loved living in America, and he knew he was blessed to be here. He loved this country, and he stood for liberty, for freedom, for his individual agency when he was called. I would like to share a couple of journal entries that I think brings a little more insight into my husband as well. I found them in his journal. It is Easter Sunday. It has been a wonderful weekend. We're rounding up Dad's cows and branding. All of the family and a lot of the extended family were there. It was very rewarding to ride with Dad, Guy, my daughters, Tian and Catriel, my nieces and nephews. My daughters can carry their own weight. They are becoming good riders and have good judgment in working the livestock. My heart is filled with joy and gratitude as I watch them run their horses through the brush and the trees, cutting the cows. Danielle Catriel with her dark hair, and Tian with her blonde hair flowing behind them. As a father, I'm blessed beyond measure. After branding, Jeanette and I rode around the old ranch house, and I pointed out all the old points of my grandparents' homestead. As we rode through around, we watched all of the families and the little children doing the Easter egg hunt. Mom and Dad's posterity have grown greatly. The joy and happiness as all of the families interacted and worked together was wonderful to see. This is the start of a new journal in the year 2012. My name is Robert Lavoie Finicum and I am 51 years old. I'm the father of 12 children and my wife is Jeanette Finicum. The world I grew up in is rapidly changing. I was born in this choice land of the United States of America. This has been a choice land and a noble country. In the more than 230 years of her existence, this country has been the standard of freedom throughout the world. I have lived to see her reach a pinnacle of wealth that has never been known in the history of the world. God raised up noble men who laid the foundations of a free government. The Constitution which they laid down was inspired of heaven for the protection of man's God-given liberties. For almost 100 years, evil and conspiring men have sought to destroy those liberties for their own power and gain. With sweet words of honey laced with poison, they have lied to us. Professed care and concern for the working man and the downtrodden, they have enacted laws that breach the safeguards erected by our Constitution. The politicians violate their oath to protect and defend the Constitution, end quote. Samuel Adams said, if ever a time should come when vain and aspiring men shall possess the highest seats in government, our country will stand in need of its experienced patriots to prevent its ruin. And I believe Lavoie was that kind of patriot. Today, we must be those experienced patriots standing for God and for our Constitution, for freedom, for truth, for righteousness. We must be the ones to stand. And if not us, then who? Then who? This last presidential election, we the people sent a message to the powers that be in Washington that we wanted our country back. We want less government, we want our government to be responsible, and we want our government to remember that they exist to ensure our God-given constitutional rights. In the Declaration of Independence, it says, and I quote, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it, and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness, end quote. Securing the rights and freedoms of the individual citizen is the most important function of our government, not securing more government, not securing their own interest in filling their personal coffers, right? What do we see in Washington? What do we continue to see? I had a friend that recommended this book to me. Many are called, but few are chosen, by Verlin Anderson. Boy, it's a short read, but it's a great book. It's a great book. And I just want to read to you just a little bit of the introduction of the book. And I think it's really appropriate for what we're talking about. The scriptures indicate that when the Lord gives to the people both a knowledge of the gospel and the power of self-government, he also places on them responsibilities of great magnitude with respect to government. The gospel teachings provide an understanding of the proper function of government, which lays an extremely important political duty upon those who have the teachings. While we may try to separate this duty from our religious obligations, a close examination of the central problem of government reveals it to be essentially moral or religious in nature. The power to participate in the governing process is the power to determine under what circumstances it is legal to use force on our fellow man. Government exists only for one purpose: to make and enforce rules governing human conduct. Every rule or law which is passed has attached to it a penalty. The penalty invariably takes from the disobedient either his life, his liberty, or his property. Under a government subject to the voice of the people, the ultimate responsibility for laws and therefore for determining when it is proper to kill a person, jail him, or take from him his property rests directly on the voting citizen. There is no other place to rest the credit or blame for what is done in the name of government. This is a moral question of the most serious nature, and for that very reason, it is also religious. Thus, the central problem of government is a religious one, and anyone who assumes he can form his political beliefs without consulting his ethics, which have their basis in religious conviction, is deceiving himself either about the true nature of government or his moral responsibility for his actions, end quote. I found that to be very powerful. Again, it says the responsibility rests directly on the voting citizen. There is no other place to rest the credit or blame for what is done in the name of government. LaVoy was very aware of his God, and very aware that he had a responsibility, a duty as its citizen to stand up for freedom, for personal agency, for the principles enshrined in the Constitution. He knew that if he did not stand up for life, liberty, and personal property, that he would be held accountable to God. He knew that the government needed to be reminded that they had exceeded their authority and that they needed to be put back within the confines laid out in the Constitution. Freedom is an eternal principle. The right to choose agency is a gift from God. It's not a uniquely American value. People all over the world yearn to be for the right to be free and to be left alone from burdensome government rules and interference. To live life the way that they choose, to make their own decisions, and the right to make their own mistakes. He knew if he did not stand, that he would be held accountable. President James Garfield in 1877 said, "Now more than ever before, the people are responsible for the character of their Congress. If that body be ignorant, reckless, or corrupt, it is because the people tolerate ignorance, recklessness, and corruption. If it be intelligent, brave, and pure, it is because the national legislator, it is because the people demand these high qualities to represent them in the national legislator. If the next centennial does not find us a great nation, it will be because those who represent the enterprise, the culture, and the morality of the nation do not aid in controlling the political forces," end quote. I think we're there. I think we're there. We the people are responsible for who we elect and who we place into office. Those experienced patriots who we elect and entrust with this sacred duty need to stand firm in securing our rights listed in the Constitution, and if not, we are to blame for not insisting so. I loved again what President Trump said in his speech in January 2017. He said, quote, "What truly matters is not which party controls our government, but whether our government is controlled by the people." He said, "January 20th, 2017 will be remembered as the day the people became the rulers of this nation once again," end quote. That gives me hope. His statement gives me hope. But will we become the rulers of this nation again? Will we become involved? Will we be educated, brave, and pure, so that when we elect men and women who are intelligent, brave, and pure, that we will know it? I don't know, will we? I sure hope so. Our family has hired Morgan Philpott and Rick Kerber to represent us in the wrongful death suit. And at this time, we are at the point where they file all the motions to dismiss. I don't know if I have any lawyers in the audience here, but this is a long, drawn-out process. We want justice, and we want accountability for those involved in LaVoy's murder. And somebody was telling me yesterday to call it what it is, an assassination. And I know that we've had some whistleblowers that have come forward with evidence, and we are praying that in our case that we will also have whistleblowers that will come forward and bring forward new evidence. We need to insist and demand from our elected and hired officials who have lied or overstepped or misused and illegally abused their positions of authority that they're held accountable for the breach of their department code of ethics, for their illegal activities, and for not upholding the Constitution of the United States. They need to be removed from office and or their jobs, not just transferred back and forth between agencies, as we have seen in so many of the recent cases, Dr. Red's and the Bundy's. That's what happens. If anybody's a hot potato, let's just move them over here until the people forget. Until they forget, and then we'll move them back over here. That's what happened with the head of the BLM Law Enforcement Division when Dr. Red was, when that case was prominent. They moved him over to Fish and Wildlife, and then they moved him back. And Dan Love never went anywhere until after the last case, and they finally fired him. But has he been held legally accountable for all the illegal activity that went on in Malheur, at the Bundy event? Absolutely not. He has not been held accountable. We need to hold them accountable. You know, we have two sets of standards in this country, don't we? We have the standard for the private sector, and then we have the standard for all the government employees. who are never held accountable for the illegal activities they partake in. Just this week, the judge ruled in our particular case that affects our case with the federal agent who lied. He ruled that the prosecutors will not be allowed to use a key piece of evidence, the 3D animated model, in the trial of the FBI agent indicted of lying about his role in the shooting death of the boy. The judge said, quote, "The still frames used were not clear images, only fuzzy smudges. The images were of poor quality, and that I am unconvinced that this methodology could accurately place the location of the individuals and the positions in which they were posed in the model," end quote. I was not happy when I read that. I have all these questions here. I'm thinking, this is very curious. You have the FBI and other law enforcement set up an illegal stop for individuals that had absolutely no warrants for their arrest. My husband in particular never even had a speeding ticket. Then the FBI sent a plane ahead in place to film the kill stop, but they do so with inferior equipment, hence the smudgy photo, fuzzy photos. Why? What is it that they're trying to hide? What are they trying to do? How are they trying to manipulate what we see? However, in court, the drones that they sent out to Malheur to take surveillance photos, you could count the blades of grass on the ground. That's how clear they were. So why the plane video that's so smudgy and fuzzy? The FBI instructed all the officers not to wear body cameras or any audio devices during the kill stop. Why? Again, what were they trying to hide? After the murder of Lavoie, the investigating sheriff found that extra shots had been fired that had not previously been reported. During this investigation, the FBI ordered that the FBI officers' interviews were not to be recorded. So when they went back to interview the officers who lied, they did not take them as per protocol. Why? Again, what are they trying to hide, and who are they protecting? In the video taken at the kill stop, it shows officers going back and forth from the truck to my husband's body, bending down as if to place a weapon on him. You can see the officers looking for shell casings later on in the video, bending down to retrieve them. There is testimony of investigators arriving on the scene the next morning of a well-worn path in the snow from the body to the truck. It was clear that the scene had not been secured. Each of these decisions to hide what they were doing could only lead us to believe that they had malice and malicious intent in the beginning, and now they are trying to hide what they have done. As my attorney said, he says, and I'm quoting him because I have to quote my attorney word for word, see if I can get it right. In this case against the FBI agent who lied and withheld evidence, let's hope that the government has done their due diligence and that they are doing more than just going through the motions against one of their own. After all, this matter deserves more scrutiny and effort than the tens of millions that they spent to kill, investigate, and prosecute the good men and women who went and stood for the Hammonds and the chronic injustices against Western families and communities, end quote. They spent millions to get through that trial up in Oregon, and millions more in Nevada. This is going to be a long process, this wrongful death case, in holding these out-of-control agents accountable for Lavoie's murder, but our family is resolute. In 2013, Lavoie wrote a book. It was titled Only by Blood and Suffering, Regaining Lost Freedom. I remember when we were going through that whole process of editing and having the publisher look at it. That was kind of a miracle story in itself. But as he was editing, he just felt like that was the wrong title. And he wanted to name it Jake's War. My husband said, absolutely not. He was very sure of how he wanted it. He knew what it needed to, how it needed to look, the picture, that it stayed the same. Only by blood and suffering, regaining lost freedom. And I think now, you know, his blood was spilt to preserve freedom. And how prophetic that title is. The proceeds of this book right now are helping our family with our legal fees for the wrongful death suit. And I wanted to talk to you a little bit about what the book is. Back in 2013, he was thinking to himself, there is so much going wrong today. He couldn't stand to listen to the news anymore. We got rid of cable because we just couldn't stand to listen to it. And we were listening to Glenn Beck at the time. And he said, I've got this great story in my head. I know I can write this book. I know it'd be a good book. And I know it would help teach and remind people of who we are. And he says, Jeanette, if he called us all together, me, Danielle was home at that time, and Tianne, and he called us all together and he said, you know, Jeanette, if you take care of the boys, and Tianne and Danielle, if you manage the ranch, then I can write this book and I can get it done quickly. And we all agreed, of course, because we were just really excited about the idea of him doing this. And we wanted to support him. And so from January 27th, 2013, he started it on his birthday. He sat at the desk or in the bedroom on the bed typing away on his laptop. And every once in a while he would come out and say, oh my goodness, Jeanette, this chapter just flew onto the pages. I just know that Heavenly Father gave me this. It just, I didn't even have to stop to check spelling, which what he usually had to do. Spell check was his friend. But he finished it on my birthday, June 20th, 2013. He said, Jeanette, he says, you know, I want you to read it. So we printed it off from the computer. And he put me in the bedroom, and he propped up the pillows behind me, and he said, here, I'll just leave you alone. You sit here and read the book. And so I'm starting to read the book, and, you know, I'm about 3 or 4 chapters in, and he's peeking through the door going, Where are you at? And I'm going, I'm right here with this. It's so good, LaVoy. It's really good. You know, because you get into it, right? You're into your book, and you don't want to be disturbed, so go away. And he probably did that 2 or 3 times, and finally I insisted that he go away. I said, you better take the boys and go work out of the ranch or do something, because you need to leave me alone so I can focus on this book. You're interrupting my flow. And anyways, I sat and read the rest of that book, and I was just in awe of how he was able to put this all in a story. And it hadn't even been edited yet. I was so impressed. You know, I didn't even know he had that in him. I didn't know. None of us knew. A friend of ours said this about LaVoy's book. He said, it's a story that tells of a family's struggle to come together to survive. It's about loyalty, bravery, fortitude, family, freedom, and sacrifice. It's action-packed. He has developed his character so well, you will hate the bad guys and be inspired by the good guys. It will leave yourself asking, what would I have done? Am I prepared? Have I prepared my children? He went on to say this, and this is, if LaVoy was here, if he had heard this, it would have just, you know, really touched him that that's what his book was doing. He said this. A major theme of the book is that the people we each are before the collapse will be the people we are the day after the collapse. So spend your time now being the people you want to be. It's about preparing your children, teaching them about faith, hard work, justice, and freedom. LaVoy's personal knowledge of the joy and love within a family is very enviable, leaving you with wanting to spend more time doing what you love and with who you love, inspiring you to not waste time. I just love that review from my friend. And if LaVoy could have read that, he would have said, oh, my focus doing what I wanted to do. Our family has partnered with the Center for Self-Governance and producing a three-part docu-series on Lavoie. Again, because we wanted you to meet and know Lavoie through our eyes and not the label lynching media. You'll understand what he was standing for and why he went to Malheur. We're really grateful to Pam and Mark Herr. Mark is here with us today. And for Jeremy Lofus, the filmmaker who have worked tirelessly, hundreds of hours on this. We're grateful for their commitment to truth and education, to freedom and the preservation of our Constitution. Because that's what they stand for, and that's what their mission has been, is to help continue to teach us. I'm grateful that they have given my husband this voice, so that you have the opportunity to meet him using his own words. Last night we showed episode one. I've seen a few of you here that were there last night. And I was really excited to be able to, you guys were the first to see it. You were the first to see episode one of this three-part docuseries. And if anybody is interested in hosting another gathering for the docuseries, please just, you know, contact me or Mark. He's sitting right here. And we'd be glad to get it set up for you. Let's see, I wanted to show, let's see if I do this right. We were fiddling with it earlier. I wanted to show you a little preview.
Hello, everyone. This is Lloyd Finicum. It's September of 2014. I'm out here on my ranch. It's great out here.
You know, I've never been one to try to cause problems. I didn't get in trouble in school. I always raised my hand. I always stood in line. To this day, I do not have a speeding ticket.
But it doesn't take too much to see that dark storm clouds are gathering.
Here is a non-local trespass fee of $92 and change, $180, $1,185 and change.
It's not theirs. I didn't buy it from them.
This tank here has been sabotaged. BLM came in here, set up a tank, and they drained it. They stole it.
We have been classified as domestic terrorists. These are real lives. These are real people. They're going to pull everybody's dreams and rights. Everybody will lose their jobs here.
Look what they're doing over to that family, the Hammond family. They threw them in jail. Tremendous amount of fines.
This isn't America. This isn't what we are.
No matter how long or short my days may be, I am going to live as a free man.
This is not a light thing that I'm doing, but I've counted the cost, and I'm willing to pay it.
He had a lot of courage and a lot of strength, and he had conviction. I'm so old. See, now here, I'm technically challenged. Sorry. I don't think you want to see it again. Oh, and again. How do we stop this thing? There we go. Okay.
America.
Okay. Here's
the
way.
The night is far spent. The
the Constitution has been shredded, but it lives in your heart. You know what freedom is and what freedom isn't. Stand. Because when you stand,
others will stand with you. That's what he was supposed to say there at the end before it was cut off. Others will stand with you if you stand. So gird up your loins, fresh courage take, right? We have it within us. These are just some pictures of us. Somewhere we were first married, he's got hair, I'm thinner, you know. I just love looking at some of those pictures. It reminds me of such a happy life I had with him. What a treasure and a gift God gave me. As I left that Sunday before he was killed, he said to me, "I love you, Jeanette. Take courage, have faith, God is in charge." And whenever it becomes really hard for me, I remember those words that he said to me that day before I left. And I continue to pray to have that courage and that hope. As like Timothy, that I will be able to say, "I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, and I have kept the faith." We all have a job to do, and there's lots of work to be done. And we just need to keep moving forward, because we can accomplish so much as a group. You know, I think back on all of this, and I wonder if, I have wondered if LaVoy, if his life, giving his life the way he did, has made a difference. And I say, yes, it has. After 2.5 years of traveling and meeting all of you, I know that it was not in vain. And I know that I will have time with him again when I leave this earth. And I'm grateful for those, that knowledge, that testimony that I have of a Savior who loves me and who continues to look out after me through many little ministering angels right here in this room and those unseen. I'm grateful for that knowledge, and it helps continue to move me forward. Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. Thank you so much for allowing me to come here and to share my story of the struggles that I've had, of the love that we have for LaVoy, of who he was, to share with you a little bit of my family. Thank you, and God bless you. Dolly Parton famously said, "Nobody cries alone on my watch." I have to say, when I first called Jeanette and told her what I wanted her to do and come and be our woman of courage for our 2018 Bonner County Republican Women's Group, she says, "But I'm not courageous." And I'm sitting there thinking, how can you think that? And she's so humble. And I truly believe that she embodies our woman of courage. Does anybody have any questions they would like to ask her? If you do, feel free to raise your hand. Yes.
What are the arrangements by which people lease BLM land for grazing?
What are the arrangements for leasing grazing land? Okay, this is something that gets really confusing. We purchased our allotment from an individual. Okay, we bought it with cash. We had to go to the bank and get a loan. We had to put our house up for collateral. I won't tell you how much, but a lot. Okay, a lot. We bought that grass and water, it is private property. That portion of it is private property. Grass and water is property. We own it. We pay for it with money. Just like you would if you went and bought a house. You have to go to the bank, you have to put up collateral, you get the loan, you pay for it. It was not a contract that we made with the federal government or the BLM. Okay, the second layer is what you're talking about. It's the lease agreement that you make with the government, okay? That is a contract of rules and conditions that you will follow, that they outline for you. They get to determine how many cows you run, what months of the year that you run, and so they're terms and conditions that you sign. It's not, and you pay for upkeep of your own property. Like as if the ranchers and farmers wouldn't do that automatically, right? Don't we want to keep our fences up? Don't we want to take care of our cattle, keep them where they're supposed to be? Don't we want to take care of the land and be good stewards of that land so that we can repeat, go back and be there every single year, right? Common sense. So my husband's, after riding with the Bundys in 2014, he wanted to look into it more, and so he did. He started studying a little more and trying to understand what Cliven was really standing for, and he came to his own conclusion that that was the stand he was going to take. And so he did so in 2015. And he decided to no longer sign the terms and conditions contract with the BLM. We still owned the grass and the water. That wasn't up for debate. We bought that from a private party. So he put his cows on early, which was against the terms and conditions he had previously signed. He did send a letter to the United States Attorney General saying, I will no longer sign your contract. And he thought for sure that it would get buried in this long bureaucratic hole, right? This deep, dark abyss. But no, that letter turned up when he went to go visit his sheriff just about 3 months before he died. He had a meeting with our sheriff in Kingman. And that sheriff had a copy of the letter. So they were paying attention. And it didn't fall into a dark hole. And the sheriff told him, now, Mr. Finicum, you're not going to be pointing any guns. You know, they've already come to see me, Mr. Finicum. They are going to handle you administratively. You're not going to be pointing any guns at them. And I've told them they cannot point any guns at you. And that was that particular meeting with his sheriff. But that was the reason he decided to not sign the contract any longer. It was a terms and conditions contract. Did I answer your question?
I'm so confused as to who actually owns title to the property that the grass is upon and the water?
The title to the property belongs to the federal government as it sits now, which is wrong as well. In my opinion, humble opinion, my husband's opinion, Bundy's, and a lot of other people that are involved in the public lands debate, they feel that the lands should go to the states in which they reside, and they don't. They belong to the government. The title is the government. But we bought the grass and the water. The miner can still mine. The rancher can ranch there. The hunter can still hunt, and the recreationist can go and camp. So all of those things are available to all of the public. But those lands should actually belong to either the state of Nevada, the state of Arizona, the state of Utah, whichever state that you reside in.
You say that everybody can use the land.
Absolutely.
But all of a sudden you could.
Well, they were limiting our use. They were limiting and telling us how to ranch and when we could ranch and how many cows we could put out there. And he just didn't feel that he needed the federal government to be a partner in his private business. And so that he wanted to take back more control that he felt that he was entitled to have. That he felt that the federal government was interfering in his enterprise.
Absolutely.
So, yes.
There was no other competitor for that grass. I mean, they had leased the same area more than one person. You had sole use of that area.
The government cannot lease that grass to someone else. That grass is not theirs to lease out.
It's just yours.
It's ours. So they could say, Mr. Finicum, you are not allowed to go on there at all year long. You cannot take your cows. And then they cannot go to Mr. Black over here and say, Mr. Black, you can take your cows on Mr. Finicum's property and have the power to do that. They have the power to keep you off completely, but they do not have the right or the power to put anybody else on that property to eat the grass.
Who gave them this power?
We did, right? Because we didn't stand up and say, no, the BLM, the Bureau of Land Management, is not a constitutional agency. Why are we allowing these agencies to have this type of control over us? Yes.
I'm wondering, is this an incremental encroachment that happened over the years, or has this been long-standing, same conditions?
No, I think it's like for the last 100 years, I think we've watched our freedoms erode little by little, most of the time unaware. If you're talking specifically about land rights, I'm not an expert, but there are some people here in the audience that know a little bit more about that than I do. I believe is it 1936 that the BLM, 35, that the BLM was brought into existence. And from that point on, they've continued to take more and more power. One of the things that really upset Lavoie was the fact that they would write internally their rules and regulations without them being voted on or talked with the public about. So they have all three branches of government under one head, is how he used to say. They had that type of control within all of these different agencies. Yes.
I've got two questions, both centering around the court procedures. The first one is on the FBI agent Astoritas. He's currently being prosecuted for lying about what happened at the stop, but not for actually firing the weapon. Is there any hope right now of the government holding him or anybody else responsible for actually shooting Lavoie? And my second question is on your...
Now, Sherry, one question at a time.
Well, I tell you now, you know.
I'm over 50, and I don't have a memory like that.
Okay,
remember
go ahead.
The question, and I'll come back and ask. It's true. It's like I forget. Okay, so are they going to hold this FBI agent accountable for actually taking those shots? I hope so. Our family is going to go sit up in that courtroom and make our presence known. We will not.
I'll be there.
Thank you. Because this is not okay. It's not okay that the government keeps getting away with these things. That he has been indicted for lying and for taking evidence from the incident. Okay, I refuse to use the word scene or crime because the crime was committed by the federal government in my mind, not by those men and women who were in the vehicles. And so from that incident, he took those two shell casings. You can see them, you can see the officers. It's dark, it's getting dark, so they have their flashlights on and they're searching the ground for the shell casings. You can see them bending down and picking them up. Then when they're interviewed, more than one officer lied, but there was only one that they could pin to the lies. And unfortunately, the judge ruled out that expert animated testimony. So they're able to continue to show that 3D imagery, but they're not able to hear the expert testify in behalf of it. So the jury will get a chance to see it, but you won't have that tie-in from the expert explaining everything that they're actually looking at, because there's other stuff within that imagery that is important for the jury to see. Because it's so fuzzy, it's hard, according to the judge, to see whether or not he is actually, if he's the one that's actually in the line of fire, of the trajectory of the bullet, and how they figure all of that out. I'm hoping that we continue to just put pressure on them to make, I think it made a big difference for the people to be in the courtroom up in Oregon. Huge difference for the jury to see us there, to see Carol and I sitting there, to see Brian's wife sitting there, to see all of these people in the flesh, and to watch our behavior and our demeanor and to see what kind of countenance radiated from us, right? Because it's hard to hide the truth of who you are. It kind of shows in one way or another. And so we are determined to go sit in this courtroom. It doesn't directly involve my case, but it does in some way affect my case, the outcome. It would affect it in a way. What's your second question? See, I remembered to ask.
How long before you think you'll be in court with your case of wrongful death? Have they given you any estimate?
This is where we are. We filed the complaint. We filed the amended complaint. We have served all 12 defendants. And now we're waiting on their motions to dismiss, because that's the part, that's where they get to file a motion. I want this dismissed. It doesn't apply to me, whatever their excuses are going to be. And then we have to fight all of those motions in court. And so that's where we are. And I believe the deadline for them to file is coming up by the end of June. So we should, I should have a little more to talk about after in July and August. So, yeah. And we're going all the way. All the way. Yes.
I believe there were three other people in the vehicle, Ryan and his wife, and...
No. Yes and no. There were four other people besides my husband in the beginning. When they were initially pulled over, Ammon and Buddha, Mark McConnell, who was the FBI informant who was driving the Jeep, correct? He was driving. They were in the Jeep behind my husband, who they were pulled over first. And Mark McConnell set up the whole thing. And so the FBI knew the plan to leave and when they were leaving, and which cars, who was going to be in which cars, because it had already been planned by Mark and he had already given it to the FBI. And what happened was, is at the last minute, when everybody, LaVoy had just wrapped up an interview with ABC News, and the reporter, John, had asked him to pose that cowboy silhouette pose. I don't know if you've seen that picture, but that is taken 5 minutes before he goes into his room, changes his clothes, and gets into his truck to leave. And David Fry was supposed to go and video the John Day event, and nobody could find David. And so Shauna says, okay, I'll get my computer and I will jump in. She was headed home. Shauna was headed home. And she says, I'll video it for you, and then I will go home after the event. And so Shauna jumps in the car. The Sharp family had arrived a few days before and had participated in the Saturday unveiling of the new Harney County Resource Center sign, and it sang at that event. And their oldest daughter, Victoria, had just arrived, and she'd been in the shower and had missed the ride with her mom. So she got in the car with LaVoy. She was 18, just turned 18. So she was the same age as my youngest daughter, minus a few months. And so Shauna got in the car, Victoria Sharp got in the car, Ryan Payne was sitting in the front seat next to my husband, and Ryan Bundy was in the back seat with the two women. Mark McConnell, the informant, didn't know that Shauna and Victoria were in that car. They thought it was Ryan Payne, David Fry, and Ryan Bundy, and LaVoy Finicum. And so a couple of cars headed out, the Sharp family and another car, a group of people. Then it was my husband and then the Jeep. And they kind of closed them into a trap. They let the first two cars go through, and then they had closed off the roads on both sides and then arrested the people in the Jeep. And when you saw what happened here, and in its entirety, if you watch the film in its entirety, you can see more of their decision-making in the first stop. At the first stop, they decide to go continue on. There's infrared, what do you call those, laser, on the back of all of their heads, and my husband can see the infrared on his hat, and he's saying, if you're gonna shoot me through the head now, because he can see the beads. And this is what Shauna is talking to me about after the murder. She's explaining to me the fear that they had in the truck and what was going on and going through their minds. And so they decide to keep going. Well, let me back up. They first put their hands out of the truck to show them that they're not armed, and they immediately take a shot off at Ryan Payne's side of the vehicle. So they had ill intent from the very, very beginning. There was no restraint on these officers. And I think we need to hold them accountable for killing my husband, of course. But I think there's a larger problem here. There's a larger problem. I do not believe, nor does my family, nor did Lavoie believe that all police are bad or that the FBI is all bad. There are good men and women that work within these organizations, but the training and the ideology, the brainwashing that goes on within these organizations, the lack of respect for the Constitution and the rule of law, this is where we need to have reform and change. We need to hold these people accountable. We need to hold their policies accountable. We need to require and demand that they serve and protect and not murder, right?
Can you speak about the informant a little bit? That's
he's a yellow belly, slipping liver. And there's, I don't know Mark McConnell that well, but I saw the video that came out right after they killed Lavoie. And he puts out a video because they were all in cahoots. They knew what they were doing. I believe they had a plan to murder everybody in that car. I believe that. And when they found out there were women, they had to change their plan. And Mark McConnell immediately went to the airwaves right after the murder and started talking about how Lavoie charged them, and he saw everything and he could tell. He was a mile or so back around a blind curve. He couldn't see a thing. So he was just the government's mouthpiece again, you know, put somebody out there that will lie and manipulate the truth to where the people will believe. And that's, they did believe it.
How was he connected to Lavoie or any of it?
You know, I think he just showed up and he was providing security. Sherry, do you have more information on Mark McConnell? He was not personally involved. Okay, my husband knew Shauna Cox, Ryan Bundy.
Ryan Payne?
Buddha. He knew Buddha. He knew Ryan. I said Ryan, didn't I? Shauna Cox, Ryan Bundy, Buddha. He had not met Ammon. He was at the 214 incident, you know, at the Bundy Ranch, but I don't believe he actually met Ammon. He just rode on the horses and then came home. He had met Cliven, and he knew Ryan. I don't think he knew anybody else. I could be wrong. There might be another person that he had known prior. Oh, M.D. Lauder. Huh. He knew M.D. Lauder because she was the girlfriend of Buddha, who was also an informant. Another Mark, yellow belly, sliver, liver, whatever I said.
Mark McConnell came from Arizona.
Thank you.
From a militia group. He infiltrated. I don't know that he was ever asked to be there, but once he showed up, he got into a level of
security.
Leadership,
yeah.
That gave him access to a lot of things. And before I forget, he collected over $100,000 from this as per his divorce papers.
Yeah. He collected a ton of money. He had a new Jeep that he had been an informant at a previous event, which paid for that Jeep.
Wow.
And then he received the $100,000 for what he did at Malheur. There were over 15 known, we know there are 15 informants from the Malheur demonstration. And there were probably 30 to 40 people on the refuge, so almost half of the people were paid informants for the government. The Bundys, and my husband in particular, did not screen people who came. They didn't worry about it. They were operating from a basis of truth and trust, and they were standing for our Constitution and for our rights and our liberties here in this country, and they weren't going to worry about who was there or run, you know, background checks or anything like that. They were in the middle of this. And I know that my husband operated on his knees in prayer. And he just was concerned with himself and how he was going to operate. And he was not in control. He was not the leader. However, because he was articulate and well-mannered, calm under pressure, what else? Older, they put him in the position of speaking with the media. And also, kind of looking over the young men that were there. he wanted to keep them calm. He told me that, you know, keeping the young boys calm and safe was number one in one of his number one priorities, because here are these young 20-year-old boys, you know, standing and guarding at night. And they're scared, but they have that internal desire to be there, to stand for freedom and to be in liberty. But they were inexperienced, you know, and so I know that he told me that his sleeping quarters was where they kept all of the long guns, and they kept them locked up all the time except for when they had to be on night duty, because they didn't want to give the wrong impression to people. They didn't want any young person losing control or nerve or whatever and do something rash. And so they were trying to keep it in control and make sure that there were no
incidents
or, you know, yeah, incidents. I'll leave it there. The aerial in the where he's assassinated, or in the pilot for where he was. That's from the plane that the FBI government put out.
And that's the same footage that they're not allowed.
Correct. Now the little square in the bottom is the footage from Shauna's camera. Phone. I always want to say phone.
It's her phone camera.
It's her phone camera. Not her. She had both. That's why I keep getting confused. Her phone camera is the little square in the bottom. And I encourage you to watch hers. And they've got it to where it slowed down. And you can see my husband exiting the truck and the bullet coming through the window when his hands are clearly in the air all at the same time. Technology is amazing where you can put these things together and see exactly what is happening from the inside as well as the outside.
Yes. Last night, Mark was talking about Federalists. Was your husband a dual Federalist?
Yes.
Was, okay.
Yes, he was. Mark, do you want to explain what a dual Federalist is?
Is she a great storyteller? She's amazing. So Lavoie was labeled by media and social media as a domestic extremist, right-wing, far-right, alternative right, anti-government, constitutionalist, patriot group, Christian group, all the things she listed from the DHS lexicon. Then he was profiled as a criminal under the 2001 Title 18, Section 230-31 domestic terrorism definition. Anyone who appears to intend to coerce or intimidate a civilian population. Put these two together, it authorizes local, state, and federal law enforcement resources to begin profiling what they refer to as threats. So now you have the label, you have the profile, and now you have resources being deployed to pay attention to a threat, right? So they were perceived as a threat according to those definitions. Now, bottom line here is, was Lavoie Finicum a domestic extremist? Everyone in this room would say no. But not according to the media, not according to law enforcement. Second, was Lavoie Finicum a domestic terrorist? Not according to anybody in this room, but yes, according to media, and yes, according to local, state, and federal law enforcement. So then what was Lavoie Finicum? What should you refer to him as in this room? That can compare and contrast to the domestic extremist label and the domestic terrorist label.
Man, community organizer.
So let me ask you guys this real quick question to help define dual federalism. How many of you want the federal and the state government to be separated? How many of you want them to be combined? Then you're a dual federalist. How many of you guys want the powers of government, executive, legislative, and judicial, to be separated? How many of you want them to be combined? Those of you who said separated, you're dual federalists. How many of you want your sheriff to be separated from the assessor? The assessor has these powers or controls, and the sheriff has these controls, and the governor has these controls, but the secretary of state has these controls. Or do you want them combined? You're a dual federalist. Lavoie Finicum was a dual federalist. He believed in the separation of governments, the separation of powers, and the separation of controls. The media, professors, entertainers, judges, many governors of the 50 plus states, according to Obama, many of those individuals believe in something called cooperative. It's taught to all of your high schoolers that go to public school in Idaho, Washington, Nevada. I've studied your curriculum. Yes, they are taught that dual federalism is antiquated and is being replaced by cooperative federalism. Cooperative federalists believe in the combination of federal, state, and local governments. They believe in the combination of executive, legislative, and judicial powers. And they believe in the combination, especially the most important issue, the combination of controls. I'll give you one example, and this is how they used the Oregon situation to produce this. They created something called a fusion center in Oregon. You heard of the word fusion center? Regional fusion centers. Okay, you can Google it. If you have Alexa, just ask her. All right. It'll be recorded and sent to the fusion center. The fusion center is the combination of Harney County Sheriff's, Oregon, with the state of Oregon's Bureau of Investigation, with the Federal Bureau of Investigation. So when they did the kill stop, all three of those entities had been combined together at that moment. Harney County Sheriff's were providing blockage. Oregon State Patrol was providing basically the assassination. And the FBI was providing all of the coordination and the footage and the drones. Do you understand what I'm saying? That is a cooperative federalist strategy. Now the FBI agents, that's not known to them. They believe they're doing their job. Now Nuremberg defense doesn't work, like in Auschwitz, just because you were providing security at the gates to murder all the Jews doesn't matter. But in this case, they don't know that they are being played by cooperative federalists. They're doing what they're taught is normal. So, you're a dual federalist if you believe in the separation of those three things. You're a cooperative federalist if you believe in the combination of those things. If you want to compete with the cooperative federalist, you have to change the entire way you think about politics. Checkers is your issue and your candidate. You play checkers with abortion. You play checkers with property rights. You play checkers with the smelter. You play checkers with the issue. You play checkers with your candidate. I need to get this person elected, that person elected. But I can tell you the chess match is with the cooperative federalists. And they are not the FBI agents. They are not the Idaho Bureau of Investigators. They're not your local sheriffs. The cooperative federalists occupy media, entertainer, judge positions, mainly governor offices. There are some private individuals who finance this stuff. But in the end, this is an extremely important issue for you guys to deal with. So,
we have serious issues with regionalization here that we're fighting. We have a city that wants to take over, regionalize everything. So would that be, would you consider them cooperative federalists? I mean, some of them.
Yes, that's happening all over the country.
Okay, because some of them I wouldn't call federal.
Mark is the expert here in all of this, and he is amazing. You guys, you really should take the opportunity. You're getting a treat here. But if you really want to know more, you really should put together a large group and have Mark and his company come down and put you through the five levels at Center for Self-Governance. It will change the way you view all of this. It will empower you to be able to fight in the corrective, most effective way. I mean, even on the smallest things, like in particular at our meeting, before you answer her question, at our meeting that I had at my house, it was probably a year and a half, but 2 year mark. It wasn't that long ago. Well, my community had been trying to put up a sign, change Yellowstone Road to Lavoie Finicum Road. Everybody who knew him loved him. And they were hitting bureaucracy. They were hitting the control of our county seat, who was very left-leaning. Why don't you just go build a statue and you guys can worship him there? You know, just very condescending remarks to the people who took the time, and you need to understand, Kingman has the Grand Canyon in between us and them, and we have to drive around the Grand Canyon just to get to our county seat, so it's 5 hours away, and all of these people went to go before the city council to have, they had gone through all the proper procedures, they got all the letters from the landowners, they had done all of their due diligence and gone in, and you would think it would be not a big deal, everybody in town wanted it. But they had rigged it, they had manipulated, and they had lied, and then denied. And they came back, and they were a little discouraged. And we had this meeting set up with Mark, and I had 12 of my friends that came and went through level one and level two that day, and they felt re-energized, empowered, and they had hope again to go and approach this another time. And they did, and they succeeded. And they have changed the road to LaVoy Finicum. It's a small thing, right? But it is, on every level, they are encroaching upon our lives. In everything, they want to take control and not allow us our own decision-making process. And so we have to stand up and we have to push back. I'll let him explain your answer now.
I think the question was, you have a regional entity coming here?
Well, there's a push for regionalization. I keep close tabs on what's going on in the city, and they want to regionalize the wastewater treatment. They want to a regionalization. They want a, what's a taxing district? They
recreational
taxing district. So they're trying to regionalize this whole area. And that sounds to me like, although, yeah, it sounds like the co-op sort of attitude, not just another name.
Yes, it is. Regional government is the infrastructure to replace state and county government.
Right.
So it was founded in 1902 by a guy named Charles Merriam. He's a professor at the University of Chicago. He was hired by Franklin Delano Roosevelt. He joined the National Resources Committee in 1934. 1935, they wrote the Bible. Now, the Bible is called Regional Factors in National Planning. It's the initial source document for regional government in the United States. FDR then commissioned Charles Merriam to go around the country and set up regional entities. First one was the St. Louis Regional Planning Commission, 1936. 1937 was Phoenix, and then so on and so forth. The first federal law they created was in 1954 in the Housing Act, Section 701. It allowed federal agencies and their agents to become technical advisors regarding grants, finances, funding, and so on and so forth. 1962, the Federal Highway Act. If you receive federal highway monies, you had to create something called the Metropolitan Planning Organization. 1966, 68, 69, 70s through 78, between 66 and 78, major federal statutes regarding regional government. 1970s through the 1980s, all 50 states added regional government to their constitution and state law. You guys have an entire statute of what are called self-governing entities. It's BS. Those are all regional entities. So if you want to get rid of that title in your statute, you get rid of a ton of self-governing entities in your state. You get rid of a lot of that. From the 1990s to the present, over 28,000 regional entities now exist in the United States at the city and the county level. There's 3,143 counties in the United States, 19 plus thousand cities. And the goal of the Cooperative Federalist is to replace the infrastructure of state and county government with regional infrastructure. So to answer your question, yes, it is a Cooperative Federalist infrastructure strategy. Now what they do on the chaos side is they create chaos between the governed, so between left and right, red and blue, gay versus straight, border, no border. Then on the inside, between the sheriff and the county commissioners, they'll create chaos, just as an example, between over the budget. Have they called for a county executive or a county mayor or county administrator yet in your county?
City administrator.
Okay, so they're starting with your city first. So they want to transfer, they want to change the form of government in what's called a weak mayor form of government. They'll do that at the county level. Their ultimate objective is to gain a foothold first in the city and then spread to the county. There's not enough time here.
You need to have them back.
The objective is the county.
Yep.
The base, I was in the military. Those of you who are in the military, the base you know what I'm talking about, base, when I say based or post or army post, the army post, the base is the city. And that becomes the base of operations in order to affect the county. So I've watched it when she ran, and the wording that they were using in her first election, for Heather back there. And now they're working on, you got parks, recreation, economic development, you have sewage, water, port authorities, hospital, therapeutic, I mean, keep going.
Urban renewals,
comprehensive plans. That's all the language that you will find in that Bible from 1935, regional planning for regional factors and national planning. Yes, sir.
It's way beyond that up here. People won't know about it. They're to the point where they're going to the next level with the bottom regional team. It's run by these nonprofits who are tax exempt, right? They get a ton of money from the Realtors Association. That's where they get a lot of their grants from, right? They are now in the process of hiring a paid regional coordinator.
Yeah,
in North Idaho.
There's 214,000 of these nonprofit organizations in the United States. You guys have barely touched the iceberg, the Titanic thing. They are very well coordinated, the Cooperative Federalists, very well financed. You don't need to be afraid. You need to learn and find out the chess game. If you're willing to learn how to play chess and get off of your checkerboard with issues and candidates, and I know how important those are because they're what you see right here and you can feel them right now. But Lavoie Finicum tried to play chess and he actually was successful. Even in his death, he did not die as a domestic extremist. He did not die as a domestic terrorist. He died as a dual federalist, trying to preserve the separation of government, power, and control, which is how our country was founded. Now, you might disagree with the whiteness of the men who founded it, the women, the blacks, the slaves, and all that other stuff, but I gotta tell you, you need to tell these people to come into the 21st century. It is a real legitimate concern that you make sure the governing are confined to their human nature with the boundaries that the founders set through dual federalism. Regional government is the governing's attempt to eliminate those boundaries.
Yes.
Go ahead. When you do your class, do you examine what's going on in a county and kind of look at what the county is doing in that manner?
Yes.
That would be
great. Yes.
Remember?
I'll let Monique announce it because we're going to be, apparently there's a class scheduled on July 14th. I don't know what time, but Monique will have more details. It's a training program. It's a chess training program. It's not education and knowledge about the Constitution. It's to teach you how to play chess with the Cooperative Federalists.
Do you go into details about how this is all financed? Because that's really the only way that we're going to attack it is to stop using the financial system.
Finance is a part of it, infrastructure is a part of it, philosophy is a part of it, culture is a part of it, education is a part of it. There's six or seven different pillars that they use to do that. Our main objective is to teach you guys how to compete.